We're here to make a new type of news.
New insights, new styles, and new topics every day.
We are News Generation.
Making news just for you. It's April 3rd here in Seoul. I'm Shin Yeun, and you're watching News Generation. Joining me in the studio is Walter Lee.
Lovely to be here.
And Kwon Joo-yeon.
Happy, happy day.
Good morning. Now, both are here to speak on behalf of people in their 20s and 30s. As usual, let's start with our news feed, which covers different hashtags and news items that have been trending on social media over the past 24 hours. Cherry blossoms haven't been booming as scheduled. That's why some of the nation's biggest cherry blossom festivals have decided to extend their running time. Yeouido, for instance, has decided to extend its festival by an extra 4 days. Originally, the festival was set to wrap up on the 4th at 10 p.m., but instead, it will last until 2 p.m. on Monday, the 8th. Moving on, over 6 out of 10 people living abroad said they had a positive perception of Korea after experiencing popular K-cultural content. In a report issued by the Ministry of Culture, Sports, and Tourism, 66.1% of respondents who engaged with Korean content said it had a favorable impact on their perception of Korea. This was a 5.8 percentage point increase from the year 2022. The report was based on an online survey conducted in November on some 25,000 people residing in 26 countries worldwide. And OpenAI announced on Monday that users can now access the chatbot by simply visiting the website instead of creating an account and signing up. This could introduce a flood of new users who may have wanted to use this chatbot but did not want to create an account or sign in every time. The company also said it has included additional content safeguards such as blocking prompts in more categories. ChatGPT was first released in 2022. In just 2 months, it hit over 100 million users. And since its release, it has gone through many updates so that users could better get what they wanted, whether that's high-quality essays or images. And we've come leaps and bounds with generative AI. And any notable updates over the past few months that you two in the studio have tried out for yourselves, or what else would you like to see AI cover from now on?
Well, I do use ChatGPT every single day. It's like a confession to you. I use it to verify facts and information, cutting down my time searching on websites. And yes, ChatGPT makes mistakes. When I search my name, Kwon Joo-yeon, it says I work here at Arirang TV, but it says I'm a Miss Korea. Incorrect. Uh-huh. Yeah, though it's not flawless, I find it quite incredible and useful indeed. And in the future, I would like to have a tangible ChatGPT robot so that it can help alleviate my work and take care of my kids and also manage the household chores for me. This will definitely make my life easier to navigate.
Exactly. A tangible robot that helps you not only with information but physically. Now what about you?
Yes, so I had actually a very good conversation with ChatGPT today.
Okay.
Before the show I asked questions like, what is the meaning of life? Tell me a joke. I also tried to push the limits of like, can you tell me a dirty joke? And it said it couldn't do that. So, they, like I said, they are trying their best to, you know, cut down some funny or, you know, outlandish things that you can ask them. But what I'd like to see them improve is the translation language model, which I've been using over the last couple of weeks and have noticed that there are a lot of flaws in it. And that's because, and I even asked, why are you not good at translating language? And it said the fact that there are idioms and expressions and also nuances that are different, like language to language. So that's the reason why they cannot do that. So once they improve this translation language model, that's when I'll start using it a lot more. But until then, yeah, I don't use it for translation.
Walter, I think we need more users like yourself to motivate ChatGPT to even go further in leaps and bounds.
Yes.
And hopefully we'll see more development there. Now, in the meantime, let's switch gears to our main discussion topic of the day. We've been seeing a growing number of dual income couples in Korea, even among households with children. Recently, the Korea Women's Policy Institute released results from a study that found that childcare was concentrated more on women than men. To be exact, women invested twice as much time into their children than men did, and we're going to be talking about this gender discrepancy pattern in the childcare time allocation of dual-income couples. So Walter, why don't you tell us a bit more about the Institute's latest study?
Yeah, so if we take a look at the screen, I can actually show you what we've got ready for you. So according to the Korean Women's Development Institute, in dual-income households, The mother of the household spends on average 11.69 hours a day taking care of their child or children, while on the other hand, fathers only spend 4.71 hours on looking after their young ones. Now, I will say that I am an outlier of that statistic, which we'll get into a little bit later, but as you can see, there is still a very much one-sided, side to who is taking care of the kids.
And Chun, would you like to elaborate more on why we're seeing such an imbalance as to why working moms are pouring more time to their children compared to working dads?
Of course. Well, the burden of childcare before going to work and after returning home was mostly on the mothers. Yep. Before 8 a.m., to be exact, mothers took care of their children at 60 to 80% of the time, whereas men, fathers, were in the range of 10% during the same period of time. By midnight after returning home, mothers took care of the children over 70% of the time, whereas men were only involved 2 to 3%. Where are their men? Where were them?
Right. Yes. Exactly. There seems to be a definite discrepancy there, but why? Why are we seeing such an imbalance in the time that working moms are spending to their child compared to working dads? Even though it seems like they have the same condition, it's both their child and they're both working.
Yeah, you're correct there. So traditionally, not just in Korean society, but in many societies around the world, the persistent perception that the childcare is mainly the responsibility of the woman. Now, despite the fact that even though they might be working, it's still somewhat handed over to the female side. I know that I grew up on that belief as well. My mother and father were both working, but my mom took care of me most of the time. Like I said, I'm trying to help change that perception and make it look cool again, or cool from the start. But Korea is a conservative society, and this traditional style of raising kids is still something that's very prevalent here in Korea.
Right. There seems to be conservative gender roles tied down to as to who should be doing childcare based on gender. Chun, would you like to add on?
Yes, of course. Well, in Korean society, parental leave still isn't freely available. While more men are starting to take this time off for their child, many still feel pressure from their jobs or their company that they work for. Therefore, many fathers find it quite difficult to actively participate in childcare due to the lack of, you know, flexible hours, working hours, or parental leave options.
And both of you have kids and are from dual income households, so I'm quite curious as to how you personally allocate your childcare time with your wife.
Okay, so this is actually sort of great timing for me to do this topic today. As of from this week, my wife goes back to work after taking a year off maternity leave. Now, before she went back to work, we had a serious talk on what we wanted for our child and how we're going to allocate our tasks. For me, the most important thing is that we, meaning my wife and I, have to be the biggest influence on our daughter, meaning that we don't want a third party heavily involved in our daughter's upbringing, for example, a nanny or a grandparent. Now, that's not having a jab at people who do it that way, because I understand that sometimes circumstances have to mean that you need a nanny or get your grandparent to do it. But just for us, since I'm a freelancer, I do have the availability to move my schedules around. So I moved everything into the morning and then took everything off in the afternoon. So my wife takes care of our child in the morning for around 2 hours. So she gets up and she feeds the baby and she takes her to daycare. Now, I will pick my baby up then from around 4 o'clock, and then until she goes to sleep, she's in the care of me. So I'm actually taking care more of my baby in regards to time than my wife is. So I'm taking on that part-time stay-at-home dad role. But yes, I'm also doing house chores and cooking and cleaning. I think I'd be a pretty good stay-at-home dad.
It's not an easy thing to do, but you are going into that ideal route. You seem to be the outlier compared to the stats that we've seen so far.
Yeah.
But I also think it's only possible because you're a freelancer too.
True.
It's more flexible with working hours. And Chun, as you mentioned, for regular time workers out there, it seems to be very difficult because paternity leave or maternity leave isn't really easily accessible by hand. But what about you as a working mom with beautiful two sons? sons. How do you allocate your childcare time with your husband?
Well, we divide childcare by sharing tasks and communicating about who does what. In the early morning, I'm in charge of my first son. I sent him to kindergarten. And the thing is, the day before, I actually prepare the two sons' bags, their clothes, and even the breakfast. And my father, not my father, but his, their father, yeah. My husband is in charge of the second son. He feeds him and sent him to nursery school. And I don't actually think this is, I'm doing parenting. I consider this as, I think this as something, spending precious time with my kids and my family. And it's quite important to consider and think about to have these open discussions and flexibility to adjust responsibilities based on your schedules and your strengths. Because like, if I've got to work late at night, he understands, he knows what to do. And if he has to work till late at night, which is usually from Monday to Sunday, I look after the kids at the same time. And I'd like to mention this, the hubby, my husband, he's not helping parenting. We are doing it together. And he knows what will happen to him if he doesn't participate in the household chores and the parenting. He will end up getting all the irritation and anger from me.
I mean, happy wife, happy life, and happy co-parenting is the way to go. But as a person who's not married, no children yet, I'm quite curious as to how difficult it is for you to be balancing work and taking care of your child at the same time. And what if we see this continuous trend of only moms pouring in, working moms that is, pouring more time to their children compared to their husbands?
Yeah, so like I mentioned, and we mentioned, I'm a freelancer, so I am able to, you know, change my schedule according to what my daughter is doing. And that's unfortunately something I have had trouble getting used to, is adjusting to her schedule when she has to go to sleep and when she has to eat. I have to be around for those times, so I have to make sure I leave work at a certain time, which can be quite difficult when you have so many deadlines to meet, and you as a freelancer, you grab every job you can, and then you have to somehow stick it within 1 week or 1 day, so that happens. But I always use this example for people who don't have kids, and they ask me how difficult having a child is, and that is, people without children, you can do whatever you want anytime you want. But with us parents, we have to rely on you know, making time for our children. It, like Jihyun said, it's actually not working. We're actually parenting. What we're doing is, though it feels like work sometimes, we are spending a lot of precious time with our children. I'm sure that Jihyun and I could actually go on for hours how difficult it is. But to answer your second question, it is hard to answer, I think. I think it is healthy for children to have equal amounts of time with both the mother and the father. However, we just know that's not possible given today's society, and hopefully we do see changes in the future. Yes, there still are more fathers at work and more mothers at home. But I'm hoping that this trend will change, and I'm hoping to be one of the people to help that trend change.
Right, and I think you are pioneering that trend. What about you, Jian?
Well, my husband and I work in the same industry. We work in the broadcasting field. I'm a freelancer, and he owns his own company. So when we have some evening schedules, we need to find an appropriate place, the right person to take care of two sons. It's quite stressful. If we can't find someone, we have to bring the two sons to the shooting place, and it's insane indeed and crazy. And when I'm sick, everything just seems to go wrong. That means only one person should take care of the two babies, two kids. And I want to stop complaining, but let me continue. Managing household chores while taking care of the two kids, it's quite insane. I mean, it's tough indeed. So if when it gets really tough at certain level, I just don't do it. I stop doing the dishes or doing the laundry and just look after the kids. And that's really good for my mental health and for the sake of my mental health, and also for the sake of their safety, the three men's safety. And I actually teach my two boys to actively participate in managing the household chores, because that will be their future. And if they don't do that, I tell my first one, because the second son doesn't understand it at all. I tell them that mummy might leave the house, like the one in the Piggy book written by Anthony Brown. The character, the mum, leaves the house because the two sons and the husband doesn't help the household chores. Mm.
And then it turns into a pigsty, which is hence why it's called the piggy book.
That's correct.
And I'd like to say it is discouraging to hear that we're still seeing an imbalance as to working moms pouring time compared to working dads. And I think it's up to our generation, millennials and Gen Z parents out there, as you're doing, Trion, teaching Alpha Generation, that it shouldn't be like that. There shouldn't be a separation there because the condition is the same. Both of them are working and it's both of their child. Now, we asked our viewers to tell us what it's like in their respective countries as well, whether there's also an imbalance in the number of hours working moms and dads pour into their kids. If you take a look at the screen, you can find out what three of them had to share with us. Let's start with Leon. Leon said, overall, Singapore is gradually moving towards more equal parenting within double-income families. However, traditional norms and social structures continue to play a role in shaping parenting dynamics. And Chip said, it obviously depends on the individual household, but in Canada, there seems to be a pretty good split. Families get up to 18 months of leave, which can be divided between parents, which is helpful. I remember seeing dads with babies at parks or walking back and forth on the street so that the moms could catch up on sleep. Sunny said, it's better compared to the past. Nowadays, it's much easier to see dads who are involved in parenting. However, there are still some tendencies that moms should be the ones who takes responsibilities for parenting, and this type of perception should change as soon as possible. And to better analyze this trend and some unforeseen consequences that can come about, we're going to include a professor of sociology in our talks, so stay tuned for a live interview. Let's now turn to Lee Joo-hee, a professor of sociology at Ewha Wins University. Welcome, Professor Lee.
Hello.
All right, so we've been trying to analyze the reason between dual-income couples in Korea spending different amounts of time towards their children, but as an expert, what do you think is the main reason there?
I think it's because Korea is still a patriarchal society with separate peers ideology that greatly emphasizes breadwinner, homemaker, gender division of labor. There are two different important structural factors underlying this strong norm. The first one is sex gap in pay. Korean women workers earn only 65% of what male workers make. As long as women's expected earnings lag significantly behind their partners, households will adopt unequal specialization strategies, and women will continue to shoulder the lion's share of childcare and housework. And such low wages also affect power relations within couples. Assuming that most people would prefer to do less housework, a partner with higher earnings is more likely to get his way in household decision-making, and he would prefer to spend his time on either leisure or market work instead of childcare. The second factor may be even more important than the first one. The extremely long and inflexible working hours also contribute to unequal distribution of childcare hours. As you know, Korea is one of the most overworked countries. Almost 20% of Koreans worked more than 48 hours per week. If some people work too many hours in a country, then others have to work few hours because men work such long hours. Almost 30% of Korean women have to work part-time. Right. This uneven distribution of working time between gender deprives men of their time to care for children, strengthening the male breadwinner model, I think.
And can you just give us an example of what it's like in other parts of the world?
I must say that despite rising women's employment, men's adaptation hasn't matched the changes in women's roles, even in most developed countries. Recent studies do, however, identify a sharp rise in egalitarian practices in some countries, especially Nordic ones. These countries have advanced farthest in the dual career model. For example, the average Danish man did 41% of the housework in his family, and almost 30% of Danish men did more than 50% of the housework even as early as in 2000s. Mm-hmm. In contrast, countries like Italy and Spain fell behind in the adoption of gender equality at home. Espen Andersen, a prominent sociologist, makes the interesting observation that division of household work is more equitable in countries that provide strong public support to families, such as childcare services and parental leave for fathers. And I should mention this, I am in Scandinavia. These policies are extraordinarily generous and comprehensive. And they also provide plentiful family-friendly public sector jobs that pay equal wages to women and men.
Interesting, interesting indeed, Professor Lee. Are we seeing this type of trend among young couples, particularly millennials and Gen Zs? And how are they evaluating this type of imbalance?
Yes, you can see this kind of trend among very young people, couples. I got the impression that young Korean women consider this type of unfair gender division of domestic labor very harmful for maintaining their career.
Yeah.
And this is one of the reasons why we have such a low fertility rate recently. Young Korean women began to embrace the typical male life cycle model. So I think an egalitarian project must somehow induce young men to embrace a more feminine lifestyle, or feminine life cycle. Otherwise, we would live in a world with almost no children, I'm afraid.
Exactly. I think getting both genders on board with the idea that childcare or domestic labor should be allocated amongst themselves, regardless of gender roles and stereotypical traditions, is key. Thank you so much, Professor Lee. It was a pleasure talking to you today.
Yes, thank you so much.
All right. And as a measure to boost birth rates in one of the lowest birth rate country in the world, I do think it's important that we better facilitate equality in domestic labor and childcare. So what are your solutions or ideas on this matter?
Okay, so here's the thing. Though I agree with equality, there are some mothers who like being stay-at-home mothers, and there are some men who like to be the breadwinners. Mm. But it also goes vice versa. Like I said, I'd love to be a stay-at-home dad, but unfortunately, because the world costs a lot, I have to go to work. But if, in my opinion, it really just comes down to the family's wants and needs. But yes, when it comes to raising a child, it does take two people, like, if it's possible.
Better understanding that it shouldn't be, I really like what you said, it's not about helping the mom, it should be co-parenting.
I know.
Just doing your job. What are your thoughts
on doing it together? Mm. So to foster greater equality in childcare, I do believe that both parents should share their tasks and they should talk about it. They should have open discussions a lot and a flexibility to adjust, you know, some responsibilities based on their schedules or their strengths or characters sometimes,
right,
as I mentioned earlier, and let moms and dads go home.
Mm.
Have this flexible working hours for them. And for the future, we should teach everybody to value both parents' roles in raising kids.
Exactly. And as the professor mentioned too, it's not just our perceptions that need to change. The infrastructure, companies, the government, policies need to be changing. And this is not just a small issue that happens inside households. I think it's a societal issue that we should all take part in and realize that equality needs to be there for us to see equality at home. Now, in the meantime, we'll be here every day from 9:30 to 10 a.m. Korea time, bringing you more topics young people are talking about. Special thanks to Walter Lee.
Lovely to be here.
And Kwon Ji-young.
Thank you for having me.
All right. And thank you everyone for watching. We'll see you tomorrow. We are
News Generation.